come, O Lord our God.
Jesus and joy and resurrection that they're just still full today, and that's why they didn't come back. I have to do these little things to keep my sanity. But I do welcome you here this morning. Welcome to Ed Barrett, who had to take the winter off. We welcome Ed back. And in the very back there, we have Walter and Marianne Piekarski. We welcome them back as well. They had a little bit of a rough winter, and it's very nice to see them back with us too. So as we do gather at this time for the celebration of Mass, I ask you to please make a private examination of your conscience. And then we now recite the Confiteor together. I confess, O Almighty God, one in the Holy Trinity, who knows the innermost secrets of my heart, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my own great fault. In your presence, O God, I publicly express sorrow for the many sins by which I have offended you. I resolve to amend my life, to improve and sanctify it, endeavoring henceforth to serve you faithfully all the days of my life. I ask all those who dwell within the Church of Christ, the Blessed Mother Mary, the holy apostles, martyrs, and faithful, who have lived, suffered, and died for the gospel of Jesus Christ, as well as you, my brothers and sisters, to witness my confession and pray for me to our Lord God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. May the Almighty and Merciful Lord grant us pardon, absolution, and remission of our sins.
Amen.
May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and with his authority vested in me, I absolve you from all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Show us your mercy, Lord.
And your
Lord, hear our prayer.
And let
our
cry you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Grant, most gracious Father, that purity of heart may worthily fulfill this holy action, establish remembrance of the Last Supper and the death of Jesus Christ, and for our sanctification and salvation. Be present among us, Jesus, our most perfect Master, because you said there were two or three are gathered together in my name, you are among them. We also ask, Lord, that through this holy liturgy, we may experience a spiritual revival and a better understanding of your holy will, bringing us together in one great family, guided by your commandments, and by love, truth, and justice.
Amen.
And may we say together, let us praise the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, invisible, revealed in triune power, for all time, now, and forever.
Glory to God in the highest,
and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you. seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, and you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, and the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, you have redeemed us through the death and the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. Grant we may benefit from the graces merited by our Savior. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Church for this morning's Holy Mass was taken from the New Testament book of the Acts of the Apostles. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Awe came upon everyone because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all, as any had need. Day by day, they spent much time together in the temple. They broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Too costly in the eyes of the Lord is the death of his faithful. Hallelujah.
Lord, I am your servant, child of your
maidservant.
You have loosed my bonds. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
I praise you, Lord, that you raised me up and did not let my enemies rejoice over me. Lord, you brought me up from Sheol. You kept me from going down to the pit.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Cleanse my heart and my lips, Almighty God, as you cleansed the lips of the prophet Isaiah with a burning coal. In your mercy, cleanse me so I may worthily proclaim your holy gospel through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be in my heart and on my lips, that I may worthily proclaim his holy gospel. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the doors were locked, where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in their midst and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. Whose sins you forgive are forgiven, and whose sins you retain, they are retained." Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the others when Jesus came. So the other disciples said to Thomas, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, unless I put my finger into the nail marks and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." Now 1 week later, his disciples were again inside, and Thomas this time was with them. Jesus came, although the doors were locked, and stood in their midst and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Bring your hand and put it into my side, and do not be unbelieving, but rather believe." And Thomas answered and said to him, "My Lord and my God." And Jesus said to Thomas, "Have you come to believe because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples that are not written in this book, but these are written that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the very Son of God, and that through this belief you may have life eternal in his name. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Living fire and soul,
devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to the prayers. And this lecture is taken from this morning's Acts of the Apostles, the lesson. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My voice is a little bit hoarse. That's because of all that green stuff out there. As soon as those snows come, I feel better. But right now, my allergies are kicking in, so it's a little bit hoarse right now. So Elon Musk, he's made a fortune off of companies PayPal, Tesla Motors, and SpaceX. He's a visionary. He sees things before anyone else. Then he has the power to make them happen. And because of that, he has a ton of money. Now, this is a guy whose hunches we should pay attention to because of his track record of success. Mark Zuckerberg, one of the richest people in the world and one of the most influential because of a company he started, Facebook. 1.23 billion people log on to Facebook every single day, often sharing some of the most personal, intimate things in their lives. So that's an absolutely huge platform from which to speak. Now, I've been sucked into that Facebook phenomenon that I used to tell myself I would never allow myself to do. I often post for Holy Name of Jesus, I often post for Women's Ordination Now, but I don't know what's on my own personal page. And sometimes I only check half-heartedly. I log in, but I'm not really paying all that much attention. That's why I had to drop Ellen Skrosky a quick email this past week to tell her the story that I'm going to tell you now. On the Women's Ordination Now page, she had posted a link to a New York Times article. Now, above the article, so before your eyes notice the article itself, she had typed in her comments, and she must have been very excited because she typed them all in capital letters, and she used red exclamation points and red question marks, and what she typed in was, "Nope, not my pastor, what about yours?" And then there was an actual link to the New York Times article. Well, those capital letters and all of her excitement, the red exclamation points and etc., that so captured my attention that I didn't have enough brain power left over to actually concentrate on the headline, which was, "Is your pastor sexist?" Well, instead, my mind didn't see, "Is your pastor sexist?" My mind saw, "Is your pastor sexy?" And immediately, my brain linked, "Is your pastor sexy?" with those great big letters, the red exclamation points. Nope, not my pastor. So, that's the story that I had to email to Ellen a few days ago. But even if some of the time for those Facebook people, 1.23 billion daily, maybe if their time is only something along that kind of line where you're not really paying attention, it's still so many people. It's 4 times the population of the entire United States of America. That's a lot of influence. Enough so that we should also be paying attention to what this guy is planning to do. Now, these two powerful men were in the news this past week. Musk has been working on the integration of computers directly with our human brains. Now, that's not so far-fetched when you think about it. If you're my age or older, when you had an assignment in school and you had to go look up things, you went to the encyclopedia. I remember there were actual door-to-door salesmen that used to come around and try and sell these shelf busters to families with kids. And that was all you had, was that one encyclopedia. And you spent so much money on it, you know, you kept it for years, even though the information could be old. So when I looked up Elon Musk, however, for the sermon, Google, in less than 1 second's time, went through 32 million sources. That's the new norm. That's what kids are growing up with. And we carry computers in our pockets everywhere we go. They become a part of the way we think. They become a part of the way we argue. And it's not far-fetched to imagine that this information power is going to be someday internalized. It's going to be someday immediate in the not-too-distant future. It's going to be linked directly to our brains. You won't have to access a phone. You won't have to access a computer. It's going to be a part of who we are. And they're already thinking about that. Now Zuckerberg, he realizes that Facebook phenomenon, it's not going to last forever. My daughter was home last weekend for Easter. I overheard in their conversation that they hardly ever check into Facebook because Facebook is more for people like my age. Now there are other platforms that they're using,
And I can't even tell you what their names are, because I don't remember what their names are, because they're that unfamiliar to me. But with this fortune and talent pool that Zuckerberg has, he is working on creating access to alternate realities to draw people in anew, just like he did when he started Facebook. And these would allow people to immerse themselves in worlds that only exist in computer code. And that's kind of like that novel that we once read as one of our book groups here at the parish called A Brave New World, where the ones who refused to access the other reality were thought of strange and as primitive. And it's not hard to imagine the allure of fantasy when the real world can be scary or hurtful or a lot worse, maybe even, you know, downright dangerous. So I mentioned these two visionaries, and I mentioned their projects because they have the ability to make them real. And if they succeed, not only are they going to change our world, they are going to change us radically. And I mentioned this on the Sunday after Easter because Easter numbers tell us that there are still a good number of people in our world who accept and believe that Christ and the church are really important, that Christ did resurrect, and that the church today, even 2,000 years later, can help connect with that kind of belief. But the smaller numbers on the Sunday after Easter, I wrote this maybe on Friday, but I knew what was going to happen because it's happened every year. If you look in the Missal, this is actually called Low Sunday. I don't know exactly what Low Sunday means, but it doesn't sound too hopeful. So everybody knows that this is not going to be as powerful as Easter. So in a changing world, where the people come to church because they do believe in Easter, they do believe in the resurrection, they do believe church is a place to touch that, they do not believe that they need to be here all the time because there's something that we're not giving them. And so in a world that is changing, with possibly huge changes just around the corner, the church needs to be more than a place we go to for only 1 hour a week, sit on a hard wooden bench, and listen. There's going to have to be more of a change, more of an interaction, because when they start playing around with computers in your brains and alternate realities off of a computer that you kind of immersed in, this is not going to work forever. Now think back to this morning's lesson. We hear that the Christians continued attending the Jewish temple and its worship. They would gather there together as a separate group, but it's still within the temple precincts. The old was still sacred to them. But layered on top of these older traditions were newer ones. The first Christians were students who listened and learned from the 12 students who listened and learned directly from Jesus. That's what Sharon read to us just a little bit ago. That was the beginning of the gospel, this oral tradition of Jesus' stories passed from generation to generation. And it also says they shared table, they broke bread, and they offered the prayers, which is an ancient way of saying that they received communion and that they did liturgy. And long before church buildings were legal, they did all of this in each of their homes. They would go from home to home to home because they didn't only meet on Sundays. They met every single day for the supper meal where somebody would say, "This is my body and this is my blood." And day by day is a phrase that the Bible uses today. Faith was a way of life. It was not a moment out of life, like a Sunday morning from 9 to 10 on Thayer Street that separated from everything else. This was their life. It was authentic, and it made a difference in their lives. Now, our world is changing. There's no way we can stop it. People are changing, and there's no way we can stop it. And that change is going to happen faster and faster. Zuckerberg's altered realities, Musk's altered minds, they're going to take us along for the ride, whether we want to go or not. And that can be downright scary. I don't know if I'm ready for all of that kind of stuff, but it can also be exciting, and it can be full of potential. The world of the first Christians changed radically, and it changed quickly, but that early church of just a few hundred, then a few thousand people, it grew exponentially amidst all of that because church offered something greater. The world is still changing, and we're still that same church, though. And we still need to think of what we offer as something greater. And that something greater was, is, and always will be Jesus Christ, the resurrected Jesus who is always with us and who still draws Christians in greater numbers to church every Easter because there is meaning to him and to that idea of the resurrection. We just need to figure out how to better share him in a world of alternate realities and altered minds so that Christ and church can still make a difference. You know, because with people changing our realities, people who are, you know, beyond government, people who are just, you know, their own entities and their own companies, with people having that power to change our realities and to even change our minds, we're going to need morals and ethics and Christ maybe more than we ever did before. So we really have to find how to make what is greater, we have to make it accessible to more people. And that's going to be our job as the faithful few who don't only come for Easter, but who come for the Sunday after Easter. So for this may we pray, in Jesus' name, amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Almighty Lord, as we gather as your people still celebrating that wonderful mystery of Easter, we offer our prayers at this time in memory of Liz DeBrincy, who passed away on April 16th of 2013, is offered by Eric, Sue, and Matt DeBrincy. We offer our prayers for Karen Herzig, who had shoulder surgery this past Friday. We pray for a quick and an easy recovery, is offered by her family and friends here at Holy Name. We also offer our prayers for Josephine Lisensky, who died just a couple of hours ago this morning after being anointed yesterday. Surrounded by her family and her friends and her faith, we ask you, Lord, to welcome her into the heavenly kingdom. We ask you to share with her family and her friends the gift of your hope and your peace. We also continue to offer our prayers for the continuing recovery of Jenny DeMera, who is now recovering at home, and this prayer is being offered by her family. We offer prayers for Liz Richmond, battling cancer and raising three young girls on her own, Alex, a 16-year-old with lymphoma Hodgkin's disease, and Alicia, a young mother of three with stage 4 breast cancer, is all offered by Cindy Benjamin. We offer our prayers for Frank Sprosky, is offered by the Sprosky, Gates, and Kirkendall families, and I offer prayers for Bishop Thomas Gannon's health and for the strength and well-being of his wife, Catherine. I also offer prayers for Maurice Lazelle, battling cancer, and also prayers are offered for Richard Poe by the Poe and Foster families, and 2-year-old Jack Soleil is offered by Marianne Foster. And we also offer prayers for Frank Marchand, also battling cancer, is offered by the Sadowski family. Are there any other intentions that you would like to offer? For all of these intentions, Lord, plus the private ones that we keep in our minds and still bring before you, and also, Lord, we ask you to bless each and every one of us here gathered, to bless those who are traveling at the end of the school vacation week. We ask you to bless those who are parish who are unable to be with us here today, and those who are parish who have chosen not to be with us here today. And for these things together, Lord, we pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord. May they rest in peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I believe in one God,
the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary, and he became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again and fulfilled the scriptures.
spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I acknowledge the baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, I will present my thank offerings to you, for you have delivered me from death and my feet from stumbling, that I may walk before God in the light of life. Alleluia. We receive from your most sacred hands, most gracious Father, the sacramental bread, with the same faith and trust as in the apostles and disciples of your Son and our Savior, when he said to them, I myself am the living bread coming down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he shall live forever. The bread I will give is my flesh. May they whose memory we honor on earth intercede for us in heaven. We ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that our sacrifice may be accepted to God, the Almighty Father. Amen. Lord our God, accept the offerings of we, your church, now rejoicing in the season of Easter, which you have enlivened us this very day, and grant us the gift of perpetual gladness, for you have given us cause for great joy when you have come back to us in Jesus at the resurrection. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. We do well always and everywhere to give you thanks through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, especially at this time when he has become our paschal sacrifice. He is the true Lamb who took away the sins of the world. Through his death he conquered death for us, and by his wondrous resurrection he restored eternal life. Therefore the angels and archangels, with all the saints and the entire church, we lift our hymn of praise to your glory, repeating unceasingly.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth, holy and glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest.
We therefore, most merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, most humbly beseech you to accept and to bless these gifts, these presents, these holy, unspotted sacrifices, which your holy church receives from you, employing you to defend and guide them throughout the world, together with her priests and all true believers of the holy faith. Remember, Lord, your servants. And of all present in this congregation, imbued with faith in your holy care, your rule, and fatherly love, wholeheartedly this day, in united spirit with all of us, forgive the most blessed Mary, Mother of Jesus Christ, likewise his apostles with all the countless hosts of martyrs and confessors who lived, labored, and suffered for the same holy cause which Jesus Christ sacrificed his life and his most precious blood, just as they believed, professed, and united with you through prayer and this immaculate oblation, which you have instituted at the beginning of the world and in time have fulfilled through Jesus Christ, and gave it to humanity as a pledge of eternal salvation. So we too this day profess and unite ourselves with you, most gracious Father, in humbleness of spirit, and accept from your hands this holy bread and this precious chalice as a longed-for gift bestowed on us by the Savior of the world as spiritual food and drink. He promised us this food and drink in that moment when he revealed his divine power by the multiplication of bread and feeding with a hungry multitude of people. Afterward, he foretold the giving of that food and drink to his disciples and friends as a more excellent nourishment when he said, "It is my Father who gives you the real heavenly bread. I myself am the living bread come down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he shall live forever. The bread I will give is my flesh for the life of the world." And afterwards, when the temporal and messianic life of the divine teacher and giver of the covenant was drawing to a close, he gathered into the upper room all of those whom he loved in a singular way, and had chosen to continue his work of salvation. He spoke to them words of deep love, longing, and resolve. "I will not leave you orphaned. I will come back to you. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Do not be distressed or fearful. You will suffer in the world, but take courage. I have overcome the world. If you live in me, and my words stay a part of you, you may ask what you will, and it will be done for you. Anyone who loves me will be true to my word, and my Father will love him. We will come to him and make our dwelling place with him. I consecrate myself for their sakes now, that they may be consecrated in truth, that they all may be one, as you, Father, are in me and I in you. I pray that they may be one in us, that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I living in them, you living in me, that their unity may be made complete. Father, all those you gave me I would have in my company, where I am to see this glory of mine, which is your gift to me, because of the love you bore me before the world began. I myself am the bread of life. No one who comes to me shall ever be hungry. No one who believes in me shall ever thirst." After these and other words of the archpriest in prayer and with holy fervor, our Savior took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and having lifted his eyes to heaven, to you, his almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat, for this is my body, which is given for you." In like manner, after supper, taking this excellent chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again he gave thanks to you, blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which will be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you shall do these things, do them in remembrance of me." Thank you. Wherefore, mindful Lord, we your servants and your faithful people, in remembrance of this Christ, your Son and our Lord, as well as his blessed passion, resurrection, and his glorious ascension, we receive from your own gifts and presents a pure offering, a holy offering, an immaculate offering, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. These gifts we receive with a joyful countenance, as from him, who is the giver of all temporal and eternal good gifts, and with an unshakable faith that they will become for our souls a saving remedy. We humbly ask you, Almighty God, to command that our offering be brought by the hands of your holy angel to your highest altar, into the presence of your divine majesty. That we who receive the most sacred body and blood of your Son from this altar may be filled with every blessing and grace through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and who have passed on to eternity. To these souls, Lord, and to all who rest in Christ, grant everlasting life, and to those during life strayed from the path of righteousness, unmindful of your fatherly love, mercifully shorten their suffering. We ask this in the name of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And grant us, your sinful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs and all your saints, who shed their blood for your name. Their hearts were always open to justice and mercy, and with lives patterned after their divine master, merited eternal joy. Number us in their company, Lord, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. By whom you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, and freely give us all these good things. Through him, and with him, and in him, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. Forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us pray, instructed by our Savior's teaching and following divine example, we say with confidence,
Amen.
Eternal life. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Do not look at our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and the unity of your kingdom, for you live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, by the will of the Father and the work of the Holy Spirit, your death brought life to the world. By your holy body and blood, free me from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me faithful to your teaching, and never let me be parted from you, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. May the partaking of your body and blood, Lord Jesus, not be caused for my judgment. Though I am unworthy to receive this great sacrament, through your loving kindness may become my safeguard and healing remedy. My saving master, awaken in me a living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy longing. Through this communion, make me your willing servant, zealous fulfill your holy will. May it at last unite me entirely with my Lord and my God. Grant this who lives, reigns in God the Father, in unity with the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. I will take the bread of heaven, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. May the body of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to life everlasting. Amen. What shall I return to the Lord for all the graces that he has given me? I will take the chalice of salvation, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. With high praise I call upon the Lord, and I shall be saved from all my enemies. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to life everlasting. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. Body.
Body and the blood of Christ. and the blood of Christ. The body 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 and the blood of Christ.
Then you shall know that I am the Lord, when I open your graves and have you rise from them, O my people. Alleluia. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, to you belong the keys of life and of death, by the will of the Holy Father. Preserve us through these holy mysteries of the Mass, that our redemption may be assured and our doubts may be relieved. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Oh, the sacrifice is offered. Alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia.
the tribute of our worship be pleasing to you, most holy Trinity, grant that the sacrifice which I, though unworthy, have offered in the sight of your majesty be acceptable to you, through your mercy may be effective for myself and all of those for whom I have offered it, through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Almighty and merciful God bless you. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John. In the beginning was the Word was in God's presence, and the Word was God. He was present to God in the beginning. Through him all things came into being, and apart from him nothing came to be. Whatever came to being in him found light, light for the light of men. The light shines on in darkness, a darkness that did not overcome it. There was a man named John, sent by God, who came as a witness to testify to the light, so that through him all might believe, but only to testify to the light, for he himself was not the light. The real light which gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and through him the world was made, yet the world did not know who he was. To his own he came, and his own did not accept him. And he who did accept him, he empowered to become children of God. These are they who believe in his name, were begotten not by blood, nor by carnal desire, nor by man's willing it, but by God. The Word became flesh, and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of an only Son coming from the Father, filled with enduring love.
Thank you.